subsoil exploration. So, as I discussed earlier, need type and depth of foundation. Second is your load carrying capacity. Of footing or foundation, then third is your settlement, fourth is your potential foundation problem, you can say that foundation problem, fifth is your water table. Then sixth is your lateral earth pressure, then construction technique. Now with this, as I discussed last time, subsurface exploration, there is a need, because why we need this subsoil exploration? Because to find it out type and depth of the foundation. What is the type of the depth of the foundation means? The first one is your, if there is a footing, if there is a footing, say this is a footing. Now, say this footing will be constructed below column, suppose say column load of 2000 kilonewton or 200 kilonewton ejected. So, in this subsoil exploration, what will happen? You need to find it out in the periphery of this, particularly up to the pressure bulb, you need to find it out what is your C and phi. Once you will take out the soil and find it out the C and phi and also permeability, then you can find it out particularly this kind of load, what is the type of footing foundation you may. It may be a square, strip or mat, raft or maybe deep foundation. Then at what depth you are going to put your foundation, this is the depth, depth of the foundation. At what depth, this all calculation will come from your soil basic parameter C phi and coefficient of permeability C C, from there it will come this calculation. This is type 1 and type and depth of the foundation. Then this is the expected, second part is your, this is your load coming to the column, this is structure. In these structures, in the columns are there, column load. This is a load coming on structure, because coming on the column because of the structure. Now, second part is your, what is the load carrying capacity of foundation? If type and depth of the foundation has been decided, if it rested on a soil, then how much load it can take? What is the permissible load it can take because of the soil? If this permissible load taken by the foundation because of soil is more than the load coming to the foundation, that is your second part. And this permissible load carrying capacity of foundation from Terzaghi's equations like Q ultimate C n C plus gamma d f n Q plus 0.5 gamma b n gamma. If you look at here, this n c, n q and n gamma, it depends upon phi, it depends upon phi, c is your cohesion parameter. So, these ultimate bearing capacity or load carrying capacity of foundation, theoretically you can calculate if you know this soil profile below the footing. So, that you can calculate how much load it this foundation is going to take, or maybe permissible load. So, this requires also subsoil exploration to find it out. This is the need for this. Then third is your settlement. What is your probable settlement? Because if suppose the settlement, if the suppose settlement criteria, suppose settlement from this C5, you can find it out immediate settlement as well as consolidation settlement. For this, you also need phi, C, CC, all the things, water content, gamma, unit weight, all the soil property you need. Once you calculate the settlement, means suppose the settlement is expected, may you can say 200 mm or 300 mm, accordingly the size of the footing you can change later on also. That is also another need. Now, fourth part is your foundation problems. What will happen? This is a footing rested upon the soil. Now, if suppose this soil below this ground, if it is expansive, what do you mean by expansive? So, what will happen in summer season? It will shrink. In winter season, it will kind of expand. So, what will happen? This expansion as well as shrinkage, both will come into picture. So, there might be, because of expansion, there might be carrying capacity may decrease or increase. If there is any foundation problem before construction of foundation from subsoil exploration, if you know, then some remedy or maybe or remedial measure may be taken. Then this is a water table. If you don't do the subsurface exploration, you cannot locate in geotechnical point of view where is the water table lying. It may be lying at 5 meter, it may be lying at 4 meter. Once you know the water table, then effect of water table on bearing capacity or maybe load carrying capacity or maybe this settlement, you can easily calculate. Now, this is your lateral earth pressure. For retaining walls means you retain soil mass. So, because it retains the soil mass, this is your retaining wall. So, it retains soil mass here. If you do not go the subsoil exploration, if you do not know what is the C phi or C v of the foundation soil as well as this soil mass which is going to retain, then you cannot calculate the earth pressure, because the soil mass will generate generally it designed based on this earth pressure, either K a or K p, active earth pressure or passive earth pressure. Maybe you can calculate from your subsoil exploration from the properties of soil, C phi coefficient of permeability, C v then coefficient of consolidation, then C c. These are the few points means why we go for subsurface exploration. These are the need. Now, for subsurface explorations, what are the program if I put it? A is your preliminary information. B is reconciliance SSIANCE. Reconciliation survey, then C is your site investigation. If I say A is your preliminary information, B is your reconnaissance survey, C is your site investigation, these three can be added. So, it is said this is the complete program. For your subsoil investigation. In this preliminary information, what we are supposed to get it? Type of structure and its use. Second is your approximate column loads and their spacing, then for bridge span length of piers. In reconciliation survey, generally you have to collect topography of site, existence of drainage ditches, then soil stratification, type of construction nearby existing building, if any, then the site investigation, this comes under planning, making, test boreholes, then collection of soil sample, then is your laboratory test. Now, if you divide whole program into this three parts, A part 1 is your preliminary information. Before you go for subsoil investigation or maybe site investigation, preliminary information you will get it from this architects or design, means what kind of structure is going to construct. Suppose there is a site, in this site what type of structure and its use, that means whether it is a simple multi-story structure for any residential purpose, or maybe for a multi-story structure for any other purpose, maybe industrial, or maybe some machine or machinery or car parking or manufacturing, what kind of these structures are there, particularly what are the type of structure and its use, that you will get it from design or maybe from architecture. Then approximate column loads, what are the approximate column load supposed to come and what would be its spacing. Once you decide, means once you get information of, means what kind of type of structure, whether it is a multi-story or single story, then second part is your whether it is for residential and or for maybe industry or maybe manufacturing or maybe certain companies. Then what is its use, means it is for storage, it is for common use, that then if there is a structure, what is the approximate, what is the approximate column load, expected column load should come, what is the approximate expected column loads. And once you get the expected column loads, then what are their spacing. This is the information, this information you will get it from drawings whatever available. Then similarly for bridge, if there is a bridge, what is the span length of piers or abutment, these information clearly you will get it from drawings or from the architect or maybe structural engineers. These type of structure, its use and approximate column loads and their spacing, and for bridge span length of the piers, this you will get it from these drawings. Now part B, reconnaissance survey, from this what you are supposed to get, topography of the site. Suppose the site is there, so what is the topography of the site and existence of any drainage nearby. Once you enter the site, you can check whether existence of any drainage or maybe any pond, existence of nearby, existence of particularly type of construction. Suppose here you want to go, this is your site, this is your requisite site where it has been decided to go for soft soil investigation. After getting preliminary information in reconnaissance survey, then this gives what is the topography of site. Is there any, you ask yourself, is there any drainage ditches nearby, yes or no. Then if there is any building nearby, you can see what kind of construction nearby, type of construction nearby this existing building, means is it a multi-story, is it a single story. If you go there, you can get, even if it is village, even if it is a village, you can go nearby and check what kind of building, what kind of construction this villager has done. Even if it is a residential, then you check in reconnaissance survey, is that building or the structure, whatever the construction they made it, whether it is existing, whether it is existing, is there any crack, anything else, that you can see the visual inspection. With this visual inspection, you can know nearby soil profile may be, nearby soil profile may be, you can say that sand, silt, clay or coarse grain, fine grain, or maybe some kind of soil, that is your expansive soil may be there. This gives a preliminary idea. Then soil stratification. Once you go to the site in the reconnaissance survey, where you will do, you just make a pit nearby. Then try to identify, once you make pit, try to identify what should be the soil stratification by visual inspection. You can look at here this from the pit, you can visual inspection, you see that is the soil profile same, it looks like, or it is changing, or it is changing from one, suppose for example, once you make a small, say less than 1 meter, you cannot make it, this is more than 1 meter particularly PIT, because this is reconnaissance survey, recognition survey, means particularly you want to give a basic idea. That means it should be less than 1 meter. Just approximately you see, is there any stratification varying? How do you know that stratification varying? If you look at this ground and look at the soil profile, if it looks kind of a gray, so throughout it should look like a gray or maybe some patches or maybe patches of black material, So with this visual inspection you can say that whether this subsoil profile is uniform or maybe soil stratification is varying. This is a simple indication, this is not giving a detailed program. This will give only indication of this, how much is your subsoil profile. Then once you get recognized survey, means the data from here after preliminary information, then the decision has to come for your site investigation. In this site investigation, planning, making test boreholes, means you have to plan. Suppose this is your site, you have to plan how many number of boreholes supposed to be done in this site, so that you can get the soil profiles and what should be your depth. Planning and making of borehole up to what depth you can go, then collection of after making this, then collection of soil samples. Once you collect undisturbed soil sample, take you to the laboratory for testing. This comes after this, once you get report from preliminary information and reconnaissance survey. Once you get these two reports, then you can decide what is your site investigation, what pattern you are going to do, and planning and making of the depth and how many number of boreholes you are supposed to do, and particularly what depth, how many numbers. This decision has to be made based on this data. Now, if I come back to your planning and making boreholes, minimum depth of boring. These are certain thumb rules. What should be in the planning, in the program, site investigation, in the planning, making test boreholes, then how do you decide what is the minimum depth below the ground surface you can go? Find net increase, of stress delta sigma under a foundation estimate the variation of vertical effective stress. D is equal to D1 when delta sigma is equal to 1/10 Q. Then D is equal to D2 delta sigma by sigma B prime 0.05, D1, D2, smaller value is the minimum depth. Now, in the third part, site investigation, planning and making the test boreholes, how do you decide what is the minimum depth of boring, how do you decide? So, first is find net increase in stress under foundation, net increase in stress. It may be find it out, you can find it out by means of Bosinic's theory or by means of 2:1 distribution. By means of approximate 2:1 distribution, you can find it out how much increase in stress delta sigma. Then estimate the variation of vertical effective stress sigma b, means how much is your vertical effective stress variation with this increase in stress, how much it is variation sigma b. Then d is equal to d 1, you can say that d is equal to d 1 provided delta sigma, that means increase in stress equal to 1/10 q, increase in stress equal to 1/10 of q. That means suppose q is equal to, q is nothing but your net stress on foundation. Suppose total load is coming 1000 kilo Newton, what is your net stress? Load by area minus this gamma df. Net stress you can find it out from your load. So, d is equal to d 1, it says d is equal to d 1. Now, this is depth, d is equal to, suppose at here it is say d 1, d is equal to d 1 when delta sigma, that means here increase in stress is there. When delta sigma increase in stress, suppose this is say up to this point, delta sigma is equal to q by 10. This you can measure plus this height is no. So, total distance will be d is equal to d 1 condition 1 when delta sigma equal to 1/10 of q. Now, part 2, if d is equal to d 2, d is equal to d 2, d is equal to say this is d 2, delta sigma by sigma b prime, that means increase in stress divided by vertical effective stress should be 0.05. That means below the foundation it should be delta sigma by sigma b prime should be 0.005. That is your d is equal to d 2. With these two conditions, one is your d is equal to d 1, other is your d is equal to d 2. With these two conditions, whatever value you are going to get it, that is your smaller. Suppose this is my d 1 depth, this is the d 2 depth. Out of d 1 and d 2, which is smaller? suppose d1 is smaller, that means up to that distance, this is the minimum depth of subsurface exploration. Means below the ground surface, you will have to go to the depth, minimum depth up to this. Beyond this, if you go, that is also fine, but this is the minimum depth you can calculate. Now, one part is over in the site investigation, making test boreholes, that means what depth? Depth of the borehole has been discussed. With this depth of the borehole, this is D and this is D2, this is D1 and D2. With this D1 and D2, what is the minimum? Once you find it out, the smaller value is your depth of borehole. Once the depth of borehole is decided, once it decides, that means minimum depth of borehole. Here minimum depth of borehole, somebody can go up to the maximum depth also, up to minimum. Maximum we can go beyond this. Second part is your number of boreholes. Once depth has been decided, in that particular area, how many number of boreholes you are supposed to do? In that particular area, how many minimum number of borehole supposed to be conducted? Now, for example, this is the area under consideration, means where you are going to do maybe high rise building, maybe multi story building to be constructed. Now you have collected preliminary information, that means type of structure is multi story and its use is suppose say residential, and approximate column loads you collect and their spacing, then also topography of the site and soil stratification and type of the construction. These two you got it from this preliminary as well as reconstruction survey. Now for site investigation, you got the minimum depth of borehole. Now before you decide the minimum number of boreholes, you have to take consideration nearby. Is there any nearby, is there any railway track is going? Is there any nearby, there is any pond? If nearby there is any pond, what is that water table bearing? If there is a nearby rail track is going, how the trains, means nearby the trains, is it a local train or high speed trains or maybe express trains are going, how far it is? It is a, you can say, multi track rail or single track rail. Suppose nearby another road is going, this road is a highway, national highway road, or this is a simple road. Because based on this, this will decide if, suppose, why I am saying, suppose if you do not consider these parameters before taking number of boreholes. Suppose number of boreholes, suppose say 2, or depth you got it based on these parameters, that up to 10 meter. What will happen? Once these rails or roads are going, it will impact vibration on this building, nearby building. Once it impacts, if you have not taken sufficient measures against this, then this there may be, might be some cracks or maybe differential settlement or maybe something will occur in the building. So if once again, if there is a pond here, how far from this pond this structure is there, where you are going to construct the building? This is very close. Once this is very close, what it impacts, there might be a chance that it may erode the soil sample. These are the factors before deciding number of boreholes to be considered, and maybe tomorrow I will discuss this, what are the number of boreholes to be considered.